Steven, it's a new year. It's 2022, and I've got a big, fat, juicy wish that it's going to be a year full of fulfillment here on You Can't Disappoint a Podcast. What do you think?
I've got a big old sauce-drenched wish myself just slapped on my plate here in front of me, and I'm going to dig in to a whole nother year of You Can't Disappoint a Podcast.
It's going to be a big year full of winding down our rewatch of Community and moving on to whatever comes next for us and to be a part of it with us. There's so many ways to show your support.
We've got a big old warm pool here for you. Come on and slip on your skivvies and slide down the ladder and dive in. How can they get in this pool, Zach?
If you put your toe in the water and it feels fine and you want to get waist deep, come join us on Patreon, patreon.com/can'tdisappointpodcast. It's the way to support this show and to help us move it forward as we move into the future. It's also the way to get more of us every week with our live pre-show every week, You Can't Disappoint Show, and all kinds of Patreon-exclusive content coming all the time, Steven.
We'd love for you to support us on Patreon, but you can also hang out with us free of charge over on Twitter at You Can't Disappoint. We are also on Instagram at Can't Disappoint Podcast, and we're on Facebook and YouTube under the whole name of the show, You Can't Disappoint a Podcast.
Also, if you would like to be a part of the show every week, you can email us at can'tdisappointpodcast@gmail.com. To be a part of next week's podcast, write us in your trivia, your favorite funny moment, and your episode MVP for next week's episode of Community, and we'll read it out loud on the show.
If you like what we do here, leave a review wherever you leave reviews about podcasts.
Yeah, maybe like the Sharper Image product review site. Leave us a review there.
There's like a box full of sticky notes at my post office. Write a review and leave it there.
I hope you guys are jumping on board with us and you're ready to traverse 2022 with me and Steven. What do you say? Let's rip our way into another episode of You Can't Disappoint a Podcast.
Cannonball!
I'll put like a big splat.
What do you think about moving up? Well, joining us on the board?
Me? I would love to be on the school board.
Awesome.
Awesome.
Well, one more thing. You're, gay, right? I mean, like, openly gay?
I'm not openly anything, and gay doesn't begin to cover it.
I have never seen The Karate Kid.
What?
I just wanted to get that out of the way immediately. I wanted to rip that band-aid off. I have never seen a Karate Kid.
There are five movies, Zach.
That's not true. There's no way.
There's The Karate Kid.
Uh-huh.
The Karate Kid 2.
Okay.
The Karate Kid Part 3.
Mm-hmm.
The next Karate Kid.
Are you sure? You're not just talking about like Jurassic Park or something? This doesn't sound right.
Then you
to
have
me.
Karate Kid starring Jaden Smith. That's five movies plus the YouTube original series Cobra Kai.
And now it's a Netflix original series and has like four or five seasons or something.
Holy shit.
Yeah. Because no YouTube Red doesn't exist anymore.
Yeah, that's fair.
Yeah, I've never seen a single Karate Kid. I wanted to get that right off the bat out there into the world. It shouldn't be a surprise. I would love for somebody to be crazy and go through our podcast and make a supercut of everything I've said. Like, yeah, I've never seen that. And then, like, talking pompously about film and television. But I'm like, eh, Wizard of Oz, never heard of it. Citizen Kane, who cares?
Like, Die Hard.
But have you seen Shrek?
The third?
Hi, everybody. Welcome to another week of You Can't Disappoint a Podcast. We're glad to be here. We're glad that you're here. Hi, everybody. I'm Zach, and I'm finally ready to come out as openly podcasting.
Nice. Wait, line?
Everything about podcasting, you just have to be confident and whatever the other thing was. So let's try it again, okay? Go ahead.
Okay.
Introduce yourself.
Hi, I'm Steven and Line.
Nice. Welcome
to
You Can't Disappoint a Podcast, everybody. Very glad to be here. We've had a little bit of a reprieve from recording about Community. So I feel energized and ready to talk about it again. How about you?
Yeah, I'm excited. You know, if by some chance you skipped the previous episode because you're binging Community, go back and watch it.
Don't watch it.
No, look at it. You got to keep your eyes open the whole time.
It is important that you not have skipped last week's bonus episode, because here in a couple months, your vote will really matter, because we will absolutely determine what podcast we're doing next. It could be up to like a 10-year commitment. Who knows how long Bob's Burgers is going to run, right? Yeah, it could be the rest of our lives.
Get to the polls. Vote.
If it's the new Simpsons, if that show goes like 20 seasons or whatever, and that's the show that people vote on, we're going to be absolutely fucked. Yeah. And it's up to them. If they vote it, and I'd love if they vote Bob's Burgers.
I would, too. Fun.
But it's important that you go back and listen to that episode and the next three that we'll do about the other shows, so you really feel like your palate's been whetted before you make that all-important vote. Let's shout out our $10 and up patrons, the people that help bring you this show and all the other nonsense we do every single week.
What if instead of shouting them out, we shouted at them instead, like a shout-at?
Okay, here's what we're going to do. I will tell the name, and since you came up with that, for each one of them, you will yell. You'll give them some piece of criticism or something.
Good, yeah. Good.
Okay, so we've got our $10 and up patrons over at patreon.com/can'tdisappointpodcast. Danny M. Lugo.
Ah! You're over there. I hope you can hear me yelling right now.
Mary Baker Budisa.
Hi, Mom!
Brian Thurman.
Brian, known you since day one. Welcome to the crew.
You're getting more like angry Jewish dad every time you yell. Planeswalker Prez.
1v1 me and Magic, bro. I only play standard, though, not commander.
That was less Jewish dad. I see that you're pivoting. And Brandon Folkemer.
Brandon!
Thanks to all of those people for supporting the show. And if you'd like to potentially get spit upon by Steven like all those fine folks just did, all you got to do is give us some money. Patreon.com/can'tdisappointpodcast. It starts at $5 to get all of our premium, exclusive, sexy podcasts that are too hot for the free feed over there on Patreon, along with shout outs, postcards, et al. And Steven, do you have anything to yell at our next shout out we got to do over at Communities on Twitter, our big time proud Papa?
I don't raise my voice at Papa. It normally doesn't end too well for me when I do.
But this is your chance. You could let something out that you've been holding on to.
I got to let my throat heal so I can yell this at our dad. This has been a lot of years coming. Why at Christmas time don't you let me sit on your lap anymore and tell you what I want? Tell me I've been a good boy!
Well, because we all remember Christmas 09.
It was an accident, Zach.
The lift and throb situation. Everyone in the family has been talking about it. We all know.
The lift and throb. For those at home who don't know what a lift and throb is, Zach, can you paint that picture for our...
Well, what I'm saying is, as you got older and matured, the moments where Papa, as you sit on his lap, as he lifts you for the present opening to commence on Christmas, there was a little bit of throbbing going on that you felt.
Yeah.
And yeah, it was true. Clear to everyone that something had happened. And now a certain side of the family doesn't show up at holidays so often anymore. Right.
Sure. That's for the best.
So thanks for the support, Communities on Twitter. You only have to put up with us for like 6 more months.
Yeah, then we'll stop saying stuff like this.
We won't stop saying stuff like this. It just won't be directed at him anymore, and I think they'll be happy with that.
Are we going to find a new podcast daddy? A podcast?
I think that's up to the universe. I hope that some Twitter follower benefactor gives us tons of listeners.
Our daddy Warbucks.
Awesome. Yeah. Maybe we'll have learned what not to do this time, but I think not. We'll
so, are we to Communities like Little Orphan Annies? And we have to call them Daddy Moonbucks?
If that means we can start bombarding him with show tunes, I'm all for it. I think he'll love that. He'll be like, I'm not your dad. And we'll be like, it's a hard knock life for
us. You're the White Annie and I'm Kwanjale Wallace. But does that make him Jamie Foxx or the big bald white guy?
I don't know what that means. I've never seen it.
You haven't seen Black Annie?
I have not seen Black Annie, but I don't really like White Annie that much, so I didn't need to see Tomorrow with a hip-hop beat underneath it, really.
It's a hard knock.
Yeah, Dr. Evil doing that in Austin Powers and Goldmember was enough for me. Let's move on.
That's the superior version.
Is there anything you want to talk about? Anything on the docket that while you've got the talking stick before I take over and don't let you say anything for the next hour and a half?
You know, my throat is shot, Zach, so that's probably for the best today.
You got all your yelling done.
Got
early.
It out. That was all I had for today.
Well, that bodes well for how many hours of content we have to produce today.
It's true. No, I'm excited to get right into this one.
Okay, well then let's do it.
Zach, I do have something I want to say.
Oh, Jesus.
I went to, on Saturday night, the RuPaul's Drag Race Work the World Tour.
Sure, RuPaul, Blart Mall Cop. Very
exactly.
Familiar.
I love fracking. I love drag. Best place for me to be. are you pro fracking?
I know you're making a BoJack Horseman reference, but...
Yeah.
Whereas usually when I'm not educated in something, I'll talk about it for hours. Fracking's not something I'm going to pretend to understand.
I see no downsides.
It's
bad.
I need
someone to explain to me why it's
some
bad.
Some people think it's good.
Ooh, the environment. I'm going to be dead. What do I care?
Yeah, 10 years, the world's not going to be sustainable to live on. Yeah, I'm going to be gone by 2025.
Come on.
So a couple polar bears don't get an ice cap to piss and shit
themselves
all over.
Give them a Coca-Cola.
Come on.
Call
yeah, like
day.
They're not swimming on Coca-Cola revenue. Jesus.
Yeah, they can
so
buy
what
a
if
house.
My grandkids never see a polar bear? Who cares?
Them in spoiled brats. But it was great. So they have like a pretty big...
I'm glad that we've accomplished in this moment that we've been loudly liberal for the last two and whatever years, but we're very anti-environment.
Yeah.
Global warming, there's just nothing that makes it seem real to me.
I didn't vote for Al Gore in 2000. I mean, I was three, but...
So how were the prancing, the prancing, dancing... Did they sing?
They lip-sync.
There's no live singing.
Uh-uh.
But on the show, don't they live sing sometimes?
Sometimes.
Does that mean that no, they don't, if they can't do it live?
Most
well,
of the
all
ones...
I know, and my understanding is very small, I know that you've sent me, like, tracks before.
Yeah.
Like, that there are original songs and stuff like that.
Yeah, a lot of those, they don't perform live very often. Now, there's, like, one person who was a finalist one season won the Australian American Idol.
That's
so
cool.
Like, some of them can really sing.
But that's not what the show is. They're not performing those songs. They're doing their drag routines.
They're like, yeah, and they're like dancing and like things. Like the because I saw the Vegas show, and the only person that was in Vegas that was there was the host, Asia O'Hara, who was a finalist in season 10, who's really, really funny. So she is on the mic a lot talking and things. And like the other queens will come out because like some of them do like comedy and stuff. So like they'll like have like some banter back and forth. But most of the ones that are on the tour are the dancing ones, so it was really entertaining. Cool
That's
theme.
Cool.
The theme of the show is basically like she's trying to go back to season 10 and not make the mistake that she made that made her lose. But the time machine keeps taking like different like periods of time, so each queen had like a different like time period that she was like doing music from and like dancing. So it was cool.
Somewhere, some like event promoter executive did a long line of coke. Like, here's what we're gonna do. We're gonna get 4,000
drag queens. We're in different time
travel
periods.
Through time.
We got a hippie one that dances with giant joints. We got a cowgirl.
5 seasons of the new MacGyver. Book it.
Yeah, but it was good. It was super entertaining.
Fun.
One of
I've
the
never
queens...
been to a drag show at all. I'd love to.
I think you would really enjoy
I
it.
Think
the,
I
like
would
performance
too.
Is great.
Yeah.
Really, really good.
I've seen some, like, maybe drag-adjacent stuff, but I've never gone to, like, a bar to a drag show or whatever.
Yeah, there's lots of ones in Chicago. There's a Sunday drag brunch, apparently, like, a 30-second walk from my front door, so I'm gonna go to that sometime.
Well, you know, I think a discussion on drag queens is enough of a slight segue into what we're here to talk about today. We're talking about the fourth episode of Community's sixth and final season. It's Queer Studies and Advanced Waxing. this episode is the second episode to be directed by writing partners Jim Rash and Nat Faxon. Previously this season, they directed Lawnmower Maintenance and Postnatal Care together. The episode was written by a season 6 writer and apparent Karate Kid superfan, Matt Lawton. This is his only writing credit on the show. And the episode originally aired on that great Yahoo screen that we now sadly have been departed of.
Rest in peace.
March 31st, 2015. Let's get into some trivia.
Let's do it.
I've got I have four
questions.
Well, I've got seven.
Why don't you go first and second? Okay.
All right. What game of Elroy's did Donkey Kong copy?
I should have gone first.
That's how it always
Construction
goes.
Snake.
Do you want me to go again or do you want to go?
I'll go.
Okay.
Who did Abed's mom take to Arizona?
It'd be just because of the heat. Was it a sister or a grandma?
Ooh, it was neither. His half brother.
Mm. Who grew up to be a sister, so that's kind of transphobic of you. My next question, 30 years ago, what was the highest position an openly gay man could reach, according to Jeff?
The center square.
Yeah, do you know the reference? You know Hollywood squares. Lily didn't know Hollywood squares, so I had to put the shame cone on them and send them to their basement.
Yeah, Danny was watching the episode with me, and I was like, not a Hollywood squares reference. She didn't say anything, so I doubt she knows it either.
Just smile and nod. That's what Lily does. Like,
Mexico
oh, yeah,
City
okay.
Circles.
That's so cool. Hollywood squares. Wow, you know everything. You're so smart. Not like you're right. I am really smart. Your turn.
Other than Chang, who has been cast by the race?
Meg Ryan.
Mm-hmm.
And Sydney Poitier.
I'll give it to you.
What do you
it's
mean?
Poitier, oh but God. Poitier will be accepted for today's purposes.
Good old
you ever seen
City
a Sydney Poitier?
I don't think
flick?
So, but I have an aversion to old movies.
That's fair.
I should watch them. I haven't. What should I watch?
What's the one he was nominated for the Oscar for?
Asking the wrong guy. I haven't seen anything.
Mm.
All right, my next question. Name as many publications
Call
from the Gay Dean montage as you can.
Say it one more time.
Yeah, I bet.
I was quoting Sidney Poitier.
Name as many publications from the Gay Dean montage as you can. There's about
Latino,
seven or eight.
Latino, Heat.
Nope.
Latino Beat. Latino nope. Dean.
Nope.
Latino
You've
Weekly.
Guessed on one of them wrong about six times.
Yeah, I'm going to get that one. Latino.
I don't think you are because you're not close.
Latino your, Weekly.
Your thoughts for the second word have not been close.
Latino Love.
Is that the
Latino
only
gay?
One that you have even a guess on?
We've got Dean Digest. We've got School
no.
Board of the Week.
Nope.
We've got Cosmopolitan. Hong Kong Vogue.
Not that one.
Tiger Beat.
Just let me know when you're ready and I'll tell
17.
You what they are. You're not getting
17
there.
Again.
Now you're saying real
starring
ones.
Zac Efron.
That's a good movie. I like it. I always thought it would work
Matthew
well
Perry.
As a Broadway musical, but didn't nice. Make enough money at
the
box office. The
Edge of 17, starring Hailee Steinfeld.
I like that movie. Okay, what we had was Gazette Journal Mirror, uh-huh. The Gay Gazine.
Nice.
Greendale Gay Watch.
Nice.
There was just like the Greendale official blog.
Uh-huh.
Dean's Health.
Dean's Health. That's
Gay
good.
Administrator, Greendale Times,
uh-huh.
And Latino Colorado.
F***.
Yeah, you weren't going to get it, but I
was not going to get that one.
No, but you were dedicated to keep trying. Do you have any other questions, Steven?
I do. How long is an albatross's fledgling period?
That's one of my questions. It Well, kind of. I'll give you the other half. 270 days?
Nice. You know what a fledgling period is, Zachary?
No.
I think.
Like before they fly off on their own?
I think so, and they're like little, and they're still in the nest.
Yeah.
That's a long-ass time to be a
fucking
baby.
Yeah, well, my
bird.
Fledgling period was about 22 years. Well, so the second half of the question, then what is the one for sparrows? He says that
Two
as well.
2 weeks?
Who cares?
10 days? I'll
give it to you. 12 days.
12
Any more?
That's all I got.
I've got three questions left for you.
Okay,
what does
time to
the
shine.
Wall... What does the
time
wall...
Time to shine for me.
What does the wall on the Karate Kid set say? Like in the beginning of the thing when he's talking to like some dude. He's like, you should come to this party.
Oh, it's like something surfery. It's like shred the reef or like coast.
You're on the right track.
Coast wave.
South Seas.
Ah!
Shred the wave. What did Abed lose in the theater?
A tooth.
You're not doing so well. A tooth? It's not even a guess. A button.
I remember. Okay, what the f*** was up with that scene, Zach? They were like, oh shit, we gotta film Abed. You'll see it. That was, it was bad. It was really awkward. I rewound
it. Okay, we'll
see. And went
back.
But
you didn't remember the button.
No, but I remember the camera work before the button was really bad. That's why I was distracted.
What does the bird's chirp signify to Annie?
That he's ready to go.
That it needs more bread.
Ni-ha-ha.
And that was a beautiful round of trivia. You did really... I don't think I did great either, but you certainly did horribly.
Yeah, the only questions of mine you got right were ones you had... That's not true. You got the Sydney Poitier and Meg Ryan one right. So you got one right, and two of them we had in common. So
I got all of them right.
Well, there was one you got wrong.
Well, let's move on and see if we can get any right of what the good people have sent into us this week.
I don't believe in myself. Okay, first email is from Brandon Folkemer.
Brandon!
Brandon! He got his shout at.
I'm starting to like Brandon. I'll put it out there.
Yeah, I
think I told him to go f*** himself last time, I'm starting to like the guy.
Yeah, Brandon's grown on me. Hey guys, I've got the feeling Zach really loved how long my email was last episode, so I'll go even deeper into my thoughts this
himself,
time.
I think. Okay, bring it on.
I really enjoyed this. It's not even that long. It's I really enjoyed this one. Jason Mantzoukas. I always have trouble saying his name. Jason
Well, that's
Mantzoukas.
Embarrassing because of what reason, Steven?
Thanks for blowing my load as early as usual, Zach.
Well, then forget it. Bring it up when you want.
No, it's, yeah, f*** you, Brandon. I'm going to talk about me now.
Well, that's what we've always done during the email segment.
So
it takes 45 minutes.
Jason
Mantzoukas. Why would
he
stop now?
He and
I
Paul Scheer
all over
were walking around Chicago, and I, like, was at a... intersection, like a crosswalk, getting ready to go across, and I was like, oh shit, I see them, but there's also a lot of people, so let me play this cool. And I like kind of low was like, hey, I don't want to like cause a big scene, but like, can I get a picture with you guys really quick? And they're like, yeah, of course, just be quick. And then I took a quick picture with them, and one of them said something.
Somewhere. They were getting somewhere.
They were going to film the show. They were running late.
What show?
They like did a show together.
Okay.
Yeah, I don't remember what it was called. I haven't watched it.
Didn't
but they were filming in Chicago.
Running into them didn't get you to watch the show.
No, but they said they were going to like film it and they were running late. But they were like super nice and it was cool meeting them. So if you go to my Instagram, which I don't know how you find that, but on my...
Well, you should send me the picture.
Oh, we can post it.
We'll post it because it's relevant to the episode.
Yeah, and we'll Photoshop you on top of Paul Scheer.
Right. You don't even have to... You can just say, this is Zach and... I'm not bald, and I don't look like him, but I think they'll go with it.
It'll work, yeah.
The three
But yeah,
we should
really
do
cool,
two
so
versions. We should do one that's the real one, and then in the replies, I'll put one.
Danny can
head
Photoshop
over
really well. She does it for work all the time, so I'll have her put your face there.
All right. Well, thanks for the email, Brandon. No time to read the rest of it.
Jason Mantzoukas is fantastic as the horribly mean theater director, and the school board guys are really funny too. Now, to interrupt Brandon again and talk about us, Zach, you're no stranger to the theater.
Of course.
Have you ever had a director that really was harping on either you or someone else, trying to pull the greatness out of them?
No, but I will share an experience that was really uncomfortable for me. I was once in this play...
Should we get the police here before you talk about this?
I was once in this play that was pretty emotionally intense, but in a community theater production, it's easy for stuff like that to really get sanded down and for it not to be understood by the performers.
Winnie the Pooh, the Broadway musical.
Winnie the Pooh Jr. So the director for this play wanted all of us to like, I forget how he worded it, and I might not be able to make it sound as intense as it was, but he said for each of us to like pick a person that we have so much held back to say to and write a letter letting all of it out to them, good or negative, and then read it on stage in front of him everybody. And I remember one, like, the lady wrote this, like, letter to her friend that she loved, like a slightly older lady, her friend that she loved, but they had like tested her a bunch of times and that she was like doubting her friendship with them. And the director, while she was reading her like heartfelt letter, would be like, stop. Now, what's this really about? And like would get more intense, like, what did she do to you? Like yelling stuff like that. And she was crying and like yelling back, like, I don't know, I don't know. And then he was like, read it the way that you mean it. And then it was my turn, and I said, I did not write one. I refused to engage. It made me so uncomfortable.
Did you get in trouble?
It's a community theater play.
Did they spank you? Fine, you're playing a goddamn tree then, Zach.
And I still did a great job without writing all my trauma to Steven on stage.
Dear McDonald's on 14th Street, this will be the last time you don't give me my burger without onions. Your ice cream machine broken the way my heart shatters.
What do you really mean?
No notes.
All right, so that's all the emails this week. Steven, next.
It's interesting to see the dean's pansexuality getting addressed and how losing himself and being a symbol to get on the school board affects him. The Chang Annie story covers some new ground as well, with Chang actually succeeding at acting and Annie having to deal with not being good at it. Plus, the surprise return of Annie Kim adding insult to Annie's failure is hilarious. The Elroy Abed Baby Birds bit is forgettable, but it does lead to some good tearful Dean apologies during the Karate Kid play. My favorite episode of the season so far. Huh.
Whoa, I didn't even get that was connected to the bird thing. The Dean's moment during the play where he's like, I'm sorry. I thought it was just a weird non sequitur. I didn't even connect the two. So thanks.
Well, you know, Zach, if you paid attention during the episode, like some of us, that would have
maybe
been
Brandon should host the podcast.
Yeah, Brandon definitely gives us some good talking points. Come on the show, Brandon. Let's talk about it.
We know what happens when we let the regulars on the show. They're never heard from again.
Favorite funny moment, either the entire Karate Kid performance or Jeff and the Dean silently trying to figure out Frankie's sexuality.
Yeah, great that moment.
Trivia. What was the name of Elroy's Donkey Kong-style video game? Construction Snake.
Good
we
job.
Know that. What happens when Frankie tries to contact the IT lady?
She keeps getting the email sent back to her in Aramaic.
Yeah.
And when she calls, there's some loud pitching noise. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Which brothers did the theater director say Chang was worse at acting than? The Wahlbergs.
I directed both Wahlbergs.
What's the name of the dean's token partner? Domingo. Which means
although
Sunday.
In the audio commentary, Dan kept referring to him as Diego. Creator of the show, everybody.
Nice. Diego would have been better.
I think Diego is a little too easy a ethnic
Domingo
name.
Is Sunday. Okay. It's not a name.
Like, people aren't named Bible and Jesus and Sunday Supper all the time.
When you're right, you're right.
I know.
MVP Benjamin Franklin Chang. Nice to see him get a win this episode. Thanks,
sure.
Brandon. Thanks, Brandon.
Thanks, Brandon.
Be a little more concise with your thoughts next time. It's a little
no
hard
trivia?
To follow. But thanks.
Huh? No trivia from Brendan?
We just did 4 trivia questions.
Really apply yourself next time, Brendan. Let's see some work. We asked for trivia. Show us the trivia.
Come on.
Who's up next?
Next, we've got... Chelsea.
Okay.
Subject
I think we've
is
heard from Chelsea one other
the girl
time.
From Destiny's Child. Queer studies and advanced waxing. Is that a line from the episode, or is she talking about
no,
Beyonce?
No, it's referencing us. You'll see. Read the email.
Oh, okay. Number one. How dare you refer to Beyonce Giselle Knowles Carter as the girl from Destiny's Child? I'm a Beyonce fan first and community fan second. When did we talk about? Did you do that?
You did that.
When?
And that was the last Community episode we did 3 weeks ago or whatever. But we were saying that as a joke, I think. We were in no way saying that we don't recognize Beyoncé as the figurehead that she is.
I've listened to Break My Soul in the last 72 hours
at least
twice. That
was the joke, is that she's Beyoncé, and Steven referred to her as the girl from Destiny's Child.
Clearly Chelsea's not from the anime community where we talk about Boruto's dad all the time. Obviously we mean Naruto, okay? Okay?
Move on, please.
Not starting off great, Chelsea, but let's try it. Hi, my name is Chelsea, and I'm not prepared to make my sexuality, which is nobody's business, an aspect of my role in society. Hi, Chelsea.
Respect.
Advanced Queer Studies is their second best of the three gay episodes, in my opinion, with early 21st century romanticism being the first.
Oh, sure. Okay.
Mm-hmm. The line, I never thought you were cool, I only thought you were a lesbian, lives rent-free in my brain, but I'm not openly anything, and gay doesn't begin to cover it, is a close second. Not my favorite of season 6 overall, but I like the Karate Kid storyline, even though Community was so close to being the first sitcom without a random Jason Mendoza's guest star episode. But isn't it better for it?
Did you say that or did Chelsea?
I said that. That was a question to Chelsea.
I really like Jason Mendoza, but I don't know.
I mean, I don't. We haven't talked about it yet, but I don't necessarily care for this episode as a whole.
At all.
But I like him.
And that's funny because I kind of am the opposite of that a little.
That's funny. Trivia. What was Elroy's pre-King Kong version of King Kong called? You want to take this one, Zach?
Construction Snake. We know the song.
Wreck-It Ralph. What time of the day is Chang's Karate Kid audition?
Oh, shit. Was it at 4? My guess is 4.
I'll go with 4.
Yeah.
Finish the line. I've got 1 year to make it all work, and that's what I'm going to do. Make it work, blank. Blank.
1 year to make it work, and that's what I'm going to do. Make it work. I don't even remember that. At all.
Nothing.
Do you got anything?
Not even a little bit.
No.
I'm gonna make it
idea.
Work, bitch. I don't think so. It still looks like there's 3 letters.
I like that though.
She did kind of a hangman thing. What other 2 actors were cast for Race before Chang? That would be the Sidney Poitier. Call me Mr. Todd. Did he say Todd? Mr. Todd. Yeah, I think so. And Meg Ryan. Favorite funny moments. Britta's reaction to Elroy yelling at her.
Yeah.
That was funny.
Insects
have wings. the Dean's I'm dying fake out moment. The line, school board, you're surrounded. Abed's mean. You just did a baby bird murder monologue. That was pretty good. Jeff and Craig try to figure out if Frankie is gay. MVP Annie. Allison doesn't get enough credit for her comedy on this show in general, in my opinion. Season 6 doesn't focus on her as much, but she's so funny in this one. Sorry, I can't subscribe to the Patreon. I have no money. I'll consider in the future when I'm rich. Much love, Chelsea.
I love that she already had clocked that we were going to turn her emailing in into, well, you know, if you like us enough to email us, you should really hop on that Patreon. And truly, come on, Chelsea, $5. I will loan you $5 to sign up for the Patreon.
Aren't I like a really obnoxious amount that's not quite $5? I'm like a $3.50 patron or some shit like that.
Are you?
I think so.
Nice.
I hope so. I didn't want any of the rewards, but... thanks, Chelsea. If I yelled, I take it back. You don't get a yell, because you don't give us money. So I'm not going to give you my vocal cords.
Not a yell.
Thanks for writing in, Chelsea. Our next is from Artie. Hey, Zach and Steven. I just want to start off by saying that I'm so happy that one of the shows in contention for future rewatch podcast episodes, one of my favorite shows, Bob's Burgers. My only concern is that there are well over 200 episodes, and I don't know if listeners want to stick with one show for over 4 years. Well, Artie, you know what? You had earned so many bratty points with us.
Why are you trying to yuck our yum, Artie?
Is that a UK slang term?
No, that's just a saying. I'm not trying to yuck anybody's yum. It's like I'm not trying to kink shame. Why are you trying to yuck our yum, Artie?
Not even counting the end of season roundtable episodes and an episode on the movie, which I personally really enjoyed.
Now we're going to do it just a spider.
Yeah, it's going to be that, Artie. We're going to do it twice. Once in English and once in another language that neither of us speak. And you're going to have to fucking deal with it. Because you're on board now, Artie.
Yeah.
So strap in. Can't wait to hear what the other show options are, but until then, I wanted to share my thoughts on the community episode Queer Studies in Advanced Waxing. If you think Bob's Burgers will take a long time, Zach wants to do a Saturday Night Live podcast.
It's not one of the options that we're doing, but I do truly want to do a twice weekly full rewatch podcast of Saturday Night Live. It's history. Go on.
Now we're going to take a look at the 2004 episode with host...
Let's see, who's that?
Chris Kattan and the musical guest.
Chris Kattan was a cast member.
He came back to host.
Oh. Yeah, I'd probably skip that one.
All right, we've got the 1985 episodes. Like the musical guest is just some guy with a guitar.
It's time for our everyone's favorite segment, Count Those Racial Stereotypes. This week, I thought the Asian caricatures were especially tasteless. But hey, it was 2012. What are you going to do? It was a different time.
Oh, boy. There's a lot of good, but there's a lot of not good SNL.
So you're signing up to do it with me? You'll do the podcast with me, Steven?
I will only do the weekend update. I'll come on just for that.
Okay.
This episode is 31 minutes long, making it the longest community episode to my knowledge, and there are definitely parts where it really feels like it's 31 minutes.
It sure is.
That's a lot. Mm-hmm. Yep. I'm not keen on the A-plot. I've never found the school board guys funny, and the way they ended the story with the dean coming out as a politician was just really dumb and surefire sign that no one in the writer's room is from the LGBTQ+ community. The C-plot is a little better. It's quite bittersweet in that some of the birds that Abed and Elroy look after die, but they are able to save one.
It flies into like an electrical box.
Well, it just
box.
Made a new home in a new internet place.
I thought it the didn't joke die. Was that something bad was going to happen.
Well,
and
that
should have
been the joke,
that something bad happened. Okay.
Yeah. You wish.
We'll get there. We'll talk about it.
The joke was that, oh, it's going to make its nest right back in another internet box.
That's also kind of funny. I just didn't read it as that. There's not a good enough accent on the joke.
The plotline also feels like a callback to the season one storyline where Abed and Troy have a rat to experiment on in their bio class. The B-plot is truly where it is at for me. It might be because I love the original Karate Kid film trilogy, but it's the best part of the episode. Finally, Ken Jeong has something to do and doesn't feel like an afterthought. I also love that they brought in Jason Mantzoukas to play the egotistical, chaotic director, as he's an absolute scene stealer in shows like Brooklyn Nine-Nine, The Good Place. He is so good in The Good Place.
In both of those shows.
Yeah. I need to watch more Brooklyn Nine-Nine. And in small doses, because I'm easily grossed out, Big Mouth. You know, Artie, I'm with you on that one.
I really like Big Mouth, especially its first couple seasons, but I get it.
I tried it. I watched the whole first season, and like, yeah, I liked the parts that I liked, but there was a lot that was a lot for me. Seeing the rest of also The League, Jason Mantzoukas on The League, that's where I first saw him, and he's just as good there as he is anywhere else. Seeing the rest of the ensemble take in and believe Chang's portrayal as Miyagi is both hilarious and heartwarming in equal measure, especially after Elroy's line, "Well, I'm a fan of the performing arts, but I'll go to Chang's play anyway," which I think might be my favorite line of the entire episode. Other little things I enjoyed in this episode include... Gay Dean, Gay Dean, Gay Dean, Gay Dean.
Cleared your voice and we still got a choice throat crack.
Yeah. The plot was silly, but that song is catchy as f***. The silent dialogue between Jeff and the Dean when Frankie lets slip that she might not be straight. Annie saying to Britta that when she acts, she can feel it pleasing the universe is especially funny when the director has no problem with her walking in and replaces her with Annie Kim. I also really like the meta joke of actors playing characters who reveal narcissistic tendencies when they become amateur actors themselves. My MVP for this episode is 100% Chang. Seeing his confidence be broken down and built anew is really endearing, and I love seeing him play one of my all-time favorite characters in cinema. I only wish we got to actually see him do the wax on, wax off bit that the episode title references. Overall, this episode is okay with moments of lighthearted fun. Not one of the best episodes in the show's run, but by no means among the worst either. Looking forward to hearing your thoughts, Artie.
Well, thanks for another great email.
Yeah, I agree with a lot of what Artie had to say there. Our last email of the week is from our acting coach slash daddy slash waxing expert, Matt from Communities. He says, hi,
if
guys.
If I had a nickel for every time I'd had a cup of hot coffee poured on me by my dad.
Hi, guys. Season 6 gets a lot of grief, but the A story here has always been, in my opinion, one of the smarter stories in television about the price of being publicly anything. I know the politics joke doesn't land for some, but I think the point of it is sharper than most lines in all of television. We are all political, we just don't like it.
All of television, wow.
Wow. Okay. My MVP is Domingo. Three lines and a ton of reactions, and he sticks the landing. Any thoughts on that, Zachary?
I love Domingo. We'll get into Domingo.
Oh, I'll get into Domingo. Trivia. What happens when Frankie tries to contact the IT lady, Diane?
We talked about this. She gets them sent right back to her in Aramaic.
Mm-hmm. What bite size pushes terabyte. Elroy over the edge? The terabyte.
God damn the it, son of bitches did it. They finally did it.
Since Matt Lundegaard only hits things that affect him, what three things will he not hit? Water, old mayonnaise, and the air after a fart dissipates.
I don't get that. What? That just all made me feel like my brain was broken. I don't know what you're
talking
about.
Well, I'm guessing he's talking about the line the director says where he's like...
Oh, that's the director's name. I didn't totally pick up his name.
Yeah.
All right. Move on without me. I'll just leave.
Answers. Her emails to her get bounced back in Aramaic, and Frankie's calls cause her to hear an undulating, high-pitched whistle that makes her nose bleed. Terabyte, and then Chang, water, or old mayonnaise. What about the fart?
What about the fart? It's a conspiracy.
Yeah.
Well, thanks for the emails, everybody.
Thanks, Dad!
We're recording things in a different way now, so to find out which episode we need emails for next, be following us on Twitter at YouCan'tDisApod. That's where we always place out the call for emails every time we're about to record a community episode. And with that being said, it's time to move into one of my favorite segments of the week. We're going to find out if, who knows how long since actually having watched the episode this week,
truly,
did Steven watch the episode
this week?
I thought about doing it in a Mr. Miyagi voice, but I figured that'd be best for everyone if I did not.
Yeah, it might be a bit...
Unlike Annie, I'm able to make those calls and not do the voice.
Don't do the
Steven,
voice.
How are you feeling? Do you think you... It's the longest episode of the series.
I feel like I should get 30 seconds this week.
That's not happening.
You know, Zach, I don't know how I'm going to do... I'm going to do
yawning.
My best.
That's not...
I'm going to do my best.
What can
I
we
shot
do
my
our
throat
best?
Screaming.
What
I...
can we do our best? I feel like you scream way louder all the time.
Yeah, you'd think. This was targeted, though.
All right, well... The timer, the stopwatch is set to zero. You've got 20 seconds to be counted up to.
Okay.
Are you ready?
I think so.
All right, let's do this. 3, 2, 1, go.
Schoolboard guys did a bad gay thing, so the dean is now the gay school dean. Then he's not gay all the way, but he's kind of gay. Then Chang is Mr. Miyagi because he wanted to be Danielson, but then Annie's narcissistic and takes over and thinks she's a star, but she's really not. Chang's a star. And then Elroy and Abed protect a bird because he's the IT guy now, but the dean gets his head, he does bad things and kills the birds.
Stop.
And then...
You said he's the new gay school dean.
Yeah.
You didn't say anything about him joining the school board.
I did.
No, you said the school board guys
did a bad gay thing.
Did a bad gay thing, so now he's the new school gay dean.
Yeah. Bars.
I don't think you did very well on this one.
I didn't get bonus points for the first 10 seconds being a rap.
It was?
They did a bad gay thing.
Now you're going to get less points because dean. That did not come across to me. Even when you sped, and then you were like, this isn't working, and sped up and tried to do it all real fast. Steven, if you're going to try to do that kind of thing, you got to look at it before you do it. You're not one Marshall Mathers. You can't just freestyle on the drop of the hat. That was a, I don't know, a C minus.
I did get all three plots mentioned.
Yeah, but at what cost?
That was the goal of mine. I wasn't going to forget the bird.
Yeah, you did get the bird. I'll bump you up to a C+.
Thank you. That was all right. Well, tough,
now we're going to talk about some favorite funny moments. Do you have many to speak on this week?
I do have some to talk
about.
Let's
rapid fire. You go first.
Line.
The way he confidently says it. Line. I liked the moment when Chang asks Abed if he has a problem with him acting now, and he says unclear, and Chang looks over at Annie and gives a thumbs up. I thought that was really a really funny moment.
I like the whole Dean's "I'm dying." Now, wouldn't you feel bad containing about the Wi-Fi if that was true?
I liked the school board guys cutting women out of sex completely. It's genius. Just their, like, cocaine-fueled discussion on what gay is like, I thought was really funny.
I'm going to say this, Zach. I know you don't agree with it. Huh. I don't normally like the school board guys that much. Sometimes they're kind of funny, but this is when I like them the least, probably.
I guess I can see that. I've always thought they've been funny, and I think the show always has used them the exact right amount.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
they don't overstay their welcome. That's okay. We'll get into it. What's your next one?
The 2/7 line is funny, I think.
Mm-hmm. I didn't write it down, but that makes me think. I like the one where if being gay is pulling a rabbit out of a hat, I'm one of those things that just keeps going. That was a really good way of putting it. I wrote down, but that wasn't one of mine, so I'm going to rapid fire another one. The "is Frankie gay" moment. Mm-hmm. The way that they both like, "Is she? I don't know. What do you think? I don't know." I thought it was a really cute moment of friendship between Jeff and the Dean. But alternatively, it's okay to ask if someone is queer. And I think she all but said she was.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a funny moment, but they could have just been like, "Oh, really? Cool."
Yeah. Right. Chang, I like the Chang acting storyline, but I like when he's like trying to get his motivation out of him. So, "Well, what's my motivation?" Yeah, like yells. I like that scene. I think those scenes were really funny. I know it's kind of a broad thing, but I like the Chang getting like his greatness brought out of him scenes.
You will notice I did not write down a single thing from that storyline.
Mm-hmm.
I wrote down another school board guy's thing. I like them grabbing the dean and giving him a noogie and going, "It gets better," as he's just like tortured. Hilarious.
I not indicting the dean to the play, I thought was funny.
Not indicting?
Not inviting the dean. Whoa! Fucked up.
I wrote that one as well. Karate Kid adaptation. Karate Kid adaptation. Yeah. Then just stands it. Karate Kid adaptation. I'm coming. And then he's there. That was really funny. Is that all you've got?
That's all I got.
I got a few more.
Hit us with them.
I've got Annie's whole thing of like, "I think the universe is telling me that I'm meant to act," like with such conviction. And Britta's like, "That's kind of dramatic." Exactly.
Yeah.
The entire concept of Domingo, I think, is hilarious. That he comes out as this, like, it just seems like a lot of times when people come out as gay in a place of stature, that all of a sudden there's like a personality list, accessibly attractive, often foreign man.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought Domingo was really funny. I think it's so clever that they never directly make the joke that they just got a guy to be his partner for appearances. He just starts being there for all of the stuff, and it's really funny. Yeah. I also wrote down the way Elroy says "bird murderer." He says it really funny, and I liked it. And the last, that's it. That's what I wrote.
Yeah.
Look, anytime I mentioned anything from the Dean plot line, your face was frown.
Mm-hmm.
You don't like it, do you?
I don't really.
Wow.
I almost do, but I truly don't.
Wow. We haven't talked at all about our opinions on
it. I know. We've been saving it all day.
So let's do it. Let's talk about it. I'll start off by saying I don't think that this episode is a highlight, but I think it does a handful of things better than the show often does with things like this.
Mm-hmm.
We'll get to it, but for example, just the whole issue of the dean doesn't really identify as gay, but he has to do this thing that he wants, but it's kind of shoehorning him into a thing, and he feels dirty because of it. But at the same time, he's creating ripples of good, and people are coming up to him and being like, it's so good to see you in this power position. I just think the way that he, I don't know, that they don't make the dean all of a sudden like this, like, I don't know, he's still the dean, but he has this wrestling of, it feels good that this is causing people to feel good, but it feels bad to not just be open about who I am. I don't know. Mm-hmm. However, I do think the show fumbles the ending in both storylines. So that's kind of where I feel. It sets them both up really well, but kind of ends them both kind of bad, I think.
Yeah, I think it's a decent idea with the Dean storyline. I just don't think that the jokes were very funny to me. I also don't like Annie in this episode. And I don't care about Abed in
the exact opposite, where I think the Dean's plot line is frequently hilarious, and I think that there's almost no laughs in the Chang storyline.
See, and the only times I laughed in this episode were really the Chang storyline. And so
this is gonna be fun.
Said it earlier, I love The Karate Kid. It's a great movie.
I will admit that I think that's a big part of why I don't get a lot out of that storyline. Mm-hmm. But I do not think it's the only thing, and we'll get to it. Let's dive in, unless you want to say something else.
Yeah, my thoughts on the episode, Zach.
Yeah, I'm glad we agree. We disagree, so I'm rejecting it.
Yeah, but I think that I think the ending of the Chang storyline is fantastic. I think it's really good to see Chang get a win, and I think that I almost got emotional watching that play at the end. I don't know why, but I love it. I think it's great.
I have a counterpoint.
Go off with his friends.
But I'll wait till we get to it in the episode.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, everyone being affected by him and them saying like, oh, it's
like
nice
the audience
to have
reactions were like the funniest part of like the whole episode to me.
There's some good stuff in there. The line where one of them says it's nice to be able to support Chang out of something other than fear.
Yeah.
That's a nice moment. I say let's dive in. I'll tell you what I think about
let's
that one
it.
When we get to it. The episode starts off with Annie and Chang practicing for the audition. We've quoted the line thing a couple of times. Something I'll mention, I think season 6, and it really is thriving with the reaction shots.
Mm-hmm.
These actors are getting so good at like quietly reacting to what the other people are doing. And I think Ken Jeong's one of the best at it. He's got this like just... As the seasons have gone on, now he's just got this like built up anxiety like bubbling in him that
constantly.
I think is really, really funny. I'd also like to ask you, maybe starting here, what you're not liking about Annie in this episode. I'm kind of indifferent. She doesn't do anything positive or negative really for me.
I think it's I'm fine with what Annie's doing and it fits her character through it all. I just don't care for, like, I even enjoy the scene with her and Britta where Britta's like, well, or you could just quit the show. And she's like, yeah, I'm going to threaten to quit. And I think the scene where she, like, quits is kind of funny. But
that's
after
the one
that,
part of that section that I like, too.
Yeah, but after that, I think she goes from, like, really bitter and jealous to not in an instant, but still kind of is. And that's
they don't
really
give her an ending, is that what you're saying?
Yeah.
I guess I get that, but I kind of like that. The turn that Chang is getting bullied and Annie is just like the golden child.
Yeah.
I kind of like it. I do think Annie acts a little stuck up in this episode and she does have a couple of moments that make me groan, but I didn't really think of it that way. Interesting.
Mm-hmm.
I do like Chang a lot in this episode. I think Ken Jeong gets a lot to do in this episode. He's asked to do things in this episode that he typically doesn't have to do.
Yeah.
And I think he does it all really well.
I think so too.
Here's something I wish the show would have done more than just bring up that Chang would like to not play the Asian character.
I agree.
I think that facet of this storyline really complements the Dean storyline very well.
Mm-hmm.
And I think they drop it real fast.
Yeah, other than the initial, like when he gets the role and they walk in and he's like, I'm playing the Asian. They don't really talk about it.
That's one of my biggest issues with this storyline is I think Community is showing on one hand that it can dabble a little bit in some more complicated morals and character dynamics and storytelling, but on the other hand, it still kind of fumbles it when it tries to. How do you feel about Elroy fitting into the group? I feel like this is the first episode, because the last one we did was the crisis room and he was just like, I don't know who any of these people are. Who's Britta? I think this is the first episode that he's really like integrated into the group. And how do you feel about it? Do you
like, having him around? I think that he and Abed's storyline is pretty inconsequential, but it just kind of like ends up looping with the Deans a little bit. But it's not bad. Like, I think that he and Abed are kind of a fun pairing together because they're both a little bit like, whatever happens, happens. Elroy's just kind of
there to have a good time, which
yeah,
I like.
Like, he's just there. You know, like, he's like, oh, MIT now? Okay, I guess.
I think that Keith David, obviously he's got his voice, but I think he brings a really cool energy to Elroy that he's just kind of down and enthusiastic for
whatever. He's fun.
Yeah, I like him in this. I like the way, and I also like him being like a man of the old internet and technology. I think that allows for a lot of really fun group jokes. Frankie kind of takes a back seat in this episode, though. Do you think that's good after she's been so at the forefront, or?
I think it's okay because
she gets a couple good moments.
I think this episode's more about the Dean and Chang. Than anything else, and so there's not really a whole lot of space for Frankie to be in one of the driver's seats. I do like when they yell Wi-Fi at the Dean.
Yeah, the Wi-Fi's down. It's a problem. Everyone's upset about it. That would suck if you're at a school and the internet is down. That's very important.
It's happened at work before, and we are a job where like we use a computer to like take payments and like schedule people and stuff, and when the internet's down, we can't do any of that.
I love the physical comedy and the way that Jim Rash draws out the okay, see, look, I'm writing it down and handing it to one of the people that's yelling at me to fix it. It's a really obvious joke, but the way Jim Rash physically delivers it, you kind of don't expect it. And, of course, Frankie making a reference to trying to email the IT lady and not getting anything back is because last season, Padgett Brewster played the IT lady.
Yeah, I thought that was funny.
I thought it was a really cute meta callback to that without putting too much attention on it, like sometimes the show does when it gets really meta with that kind of thing. I thought it was a perfect reference to it, that if you miss it, doesn't matter. If you're one of those people that's like, oh, but actually in season 5, episode 6, Padgett Brewster played, it doesn't matter. There's a little reference to here, and I think it's funny. Elroy's the new IT lady. I think it's fitting, and I also do like that they refer to him as the IT lady.
Yeah, that's really funny.
That's his new job title. Elroy gets all, like, kind of last week when he had some of the bits like, well, that and 65 cents could get you a candy bar back in my day. And in this one, when he goes the whole, Terra, what are they up to now? Terra? Oh, my God.
What are they up to, Mega?
They've done it. They really did it. It's like his, like, Planet of the Apes moment where he sees the Statue of Liberty. I love those moments with Elroy.
Really good.
Elroy and Abed are teamed up to work on this issue to go do their storyline. You're right. It's inconsequential. We'll talk about it a little bit. I do think it's the kind of inconsequential that works just fine in a show in its 6th season with a lot of characters on its 101st episode.
But I also think that without that storyline, we'd have a 23-minute episode instead of a 30-minute one.
And here, what's interesting to me, though, is I'm sure we could find some things to cut out of this episode. I almost feel like my problem isn't that stuff needs to be cut out. It's that certain things weren't fleshed out the way that they should be.
Yeah,
I think it's fine that this episode's 30 minutes. And I think it's fine that 5 minutes of that isn't inconsequential. Because it's cute to see Abed care about an animal. And there's some funny moments within it. It doesn't bother me. I just really needed these heavy topics when it's talking about race and sexuality for them to, sure, they have to kind of write it off at the end in a way that lets us keep going to the next episode. But I wish they'd just tried a little bit harder to
do
give it
they,
a
though, have to
conclusion.
Write it off in the way they did? Because I think the ending is terrible.
The Dean ending
is bad. I think it's stupid.
I think it's stupid, too.
And
we'll
I think
to
it ruins the episode.
I don't think it ruins the episode. I don't think it's terrible. But I think it's a very big missed opportunity to do something important with a, I don't know, we don't have, obviously the Dean's sexuality has always been a joke and we can talk about that, and it's a funny joke, but how many characters on TV are there that are some type of queer other than just gay? None. And the stuff that they kind of hint at in this episode is funny and interesting and refreshing for a sitcom in 2015. But the ending is really disappointing.
Mm-hmm.
Like, the Dean absolutely should have gotten his moment to be, this is who I am, and everyone's okay with it.
Yeah.
And he still gets kicked off the school board because they only want him because he's gay. I don't know, something like that.
Mm-hmm.
I love him. Well, the joke you mentioned about him be like, well, I'm dying, that's why I'm here. Not really, but could you imagine? But what he's really there for is to ask if his tie is too short or long.
Yeah.
And they give him nothing.
People are no help.
There's no, like, I'm coming in to talk about a dance or anything more. He's just there to ask for advice. Right. He very much, he's like the Chang of season two that wanted so desperately to be in the study group but was excluded from it. It's like they're just not quite letting him in, and it's time. It's time to let him in. So after
knock,
the
knock,
theme
knock.
Yeah, after the theme song, the main storyline for the Dean is kicking off with the school board barging in with their next idea for the Dean. Steven, I had no idea that you didn't like these characters. Obviously, it doesn't matter in the long run, but I'm a little blustered about it because I think these characters are so funny.
I don't think I've ever I think that they can be funny sometimes. I liked them more when the whole fake Dean thing was going on than I do now.
That's like my least favorite thing that they did, because I love them in season 5 with the I robbed your brain or whatever. I think that's really
Yeah,
funny.
That was really good.
I really like whenever they're like whenever it's stuff like we're drunk, but good luck proving it. I don't know, just that they're just the in a world where all of the people working for this school are like not professional and are not good at their job. I feel like they're very reminiscent of the real world type of frat bros who are running these types of things, who are making these decisions. And in this episode, I think the way that they utilize these characters for kind of adjacent to, like, in Pride Month, all of the brands all of a sudden putting rainbows and stuff on, they're absolutely, I think, great being used as the type of people today that don't understand gay people, but understand that understanding gay people is important now.
Yeah.
So we've got to just do it. And it's just performative activism that's actually doing more damage than it is good. I think they're funny and they bring thoughts of that up to me. And it's one of my favorite parts of the episode. So it kind of surprises me you don't like it. I'll be honest, I don't think I've ever in my life understood what a school board does.
Well, usually a school board...
Because he's not leaving his position as the dean to do it. He's just also serving on the school board.
Yeah.
And but what, like, do they do? Just make this vote on decisions to be made?
Yeah. But normally, like, I don't know. It would be weird to be dean of a school and be on the board of the school because it's a conflict of interest. But I guess they don't really give a shit, do they?
I think you're right, and I don't think they give a shit. It's important not to gloss over that you are openly gay, right? Well, I'm not openly anything, and gay doesn't even begin to cover it.
Yeah, that's a great
Because they're making
line.
A joke based on the history of this character, but like in the real world definition of queerness, that actually says a lot.
Mm-hmm.
Because there are so many ways to be queer.
Yeah.
You can be a man that's only attracted to men and not consider yourself gay and have your title for it that works, and not everybody has to get it, and that's fine.
Yeah.
And you can be gay and not act or identify. I don't know. I think it's...
Yeah, there's a lot more layers to it than...
It's tricky territory that sitcoms usually don't go into, and I think the little bit that they do here is effective, and as someone who kind of has a complicated relationship with my sexuality and doesn't exactly know what I would label myself as, and would certainly have trouble in the same situation that the Dean is in to just call myself gay, because that's not what I would call myself, but it's also not false. I don't know. I think it's interesting. And you do not see that on shows, even shows that try to be progressive with their gay characters.
No, you don't. So funny enough, Zach, yesterday I watched an episode of The Office, Gay Witch Hunt.
Okay, which is a funny episode.
It's a very funny episode. Aging. He says the F slur and the R word several times in the first 10 seconds of the episode, like first minute. And it's like jarring to hear that. But it's funny how even how much further ahead this episode is than, you know, then. And then now this, even this episode now, if it were made, I think would be made differently.
I agree. And I even think it's further than some of Community's gay episodes previously.
Yeah.
And within its own history. I remember us thinking advanced gay was going to be problematic and it wasn't
and
that
then we
bad.
Liked it. Yeah.
But I don't think it really had much to say about queerness or being queer. And it definitely didn't have a character within our main characters that was like our queer voice.
Not at all.
So I think this episode does that a lot better. It's an interesting issue because the dean's really excited about this position. He's always wanted to be on the school board. And it is just so clearly from the very beginning that it's purely because of the fragment of his sexuality that would make the school board look progressive in a way that they've recently looked the opposite of. I think that it's not like a straight pride parade joke, that it's a school board pride
parade. Yeah, that's really funny.
I think is pretty funny.
Well, and I like that the dean knows from the beginning that he's being asked to be made like a token, you know?
It's really great that they don't treat him like a doofus in this episode, but they also don't make him not the character that he's always been.
Mm-hmm.
I also think there's some funny bits here. Like, them singing the gay dean thing isn't really that funny.
Yeah, I didn't like when they sang it, but I like it when it plays later.
That's what it is. The first time you watch this episode, it's not funny, but I do think it's funny that something that they sing jokingly then comes in as a real song later.
Yeah.
Like, that you're not expecting it, and then there's this whole fully produced track of it, I think is funny. And the way that they dance together, I also, did we miss the whole thing when they were talking about what it would be like to be gay? And
well, all they said was, wow, taking women out of sex?
It's genius. I think that's really funny. Because there are some, like, look, to an extent, I feel like a man having sex with another man is an extreme display of masculinity. Because it's rough and it's brutal and it can be, you know, and it's like effeminated. But I like the idea that when these straight alpha men who might have a little bit of underlying homosexuality, they're like, yeah, the girls like girling everything up. That's kind of gay.
Suck.
If we got rid of the girls and just the men like getting the business done, just pounding and getting that shit out. That's genius.
Brilliant.
I think that bit's funny.
Yeah.
This I thought was dumb. When Abed and Elroy are outside, like, looking for the cause of the Wi-Fi to be out, and they're outside, and he's pointing at, like, an electrical outlet and a thing that runs wires through, and he's like, this one, this will run to the router. What? The router would be inside, first of all. The only thing that this would be affecting would be, like, the electricity.
Correct.
Not the Wi-Fi.
Yes. You're right on all counts, Zach.
Unless there was some type of, like, outside phone box or something or a cable box, I don't know, for, like, a school that is this big. I don't know. I just don't think the science quite tracks here.
Also, the nest being there would not be the only problem. A nest doesn't inherently break the internet. If the wires were cut up by the bird, sure.
And they don't make any jokes with anything like that.
Yeah. It's just that there's a nest there that they have to move.
Also, do you think that a little bit, Abed's instant, like, tough, tense protection of this nest, do you think it's kind of infantilizing him a little bit?
I think that it makes sense because of Abed's connection to his mom. I think they're trying to remind us about Abed's uncontrollable Christmas.
Oh,
but then
I didn't
Abed
think
makes
about
a
that.
Joke about it 10 minutes later. So I don't know. I think I would have preferred an episode where they, like, if they're going to make a long ass episode, take the time, have Chang really care about being cast because of being Asian, have Abed have an emotional thing where he's like, you know, I saw myself in these baby birds. I don't want, because my mom left and didn't come back, and now
we
she's kind, not coming
We don't
back.
Get that, but we do get the line of, like, I think the one that's still alive is his innocence or whatever.
Yeah.
I think maybe you're right. Not even go as far into an emotional beat as you are, but if there are a couple more references to Abed projecting himself onto the birds and maybe going a little crazy, but instead it's just, like, supposed to be, like, real cute bait.
You get a little montage where the birds are alive, then the birds are dead, but okay, one's still alive, and now he's free. But not really, because he still lives in a cable box.
And that's... I like Elroy in this argument they have here, where he's just, like, cold, unflinching, like, who cares if the birds die? We need Wi-Fi. Let me ask you, what side would you be on? Dispose of the bird's nest? If we're move living in some fantasy world where it would fix the Wi-Fi, you move the nest?
Move the nest.
I think I'd first be like, is there a way we can keep the nest and have Wi-Fi? No, then I guess we have to move the nest.
I mean, sure.
Is there anything we can do so the... Yeah, I don't know.
Is there anything I can do with minimal effort that I can get done right now in almost the same amount of time as just moving the nest?
Uh-huh.
Then sure, save the damn birds, I guess. Right. But don't build your fucking nest in a cable box. There's trees all around this campus. We're in Colorado. Don't be fucking stupid.
You're absolutely right.
Yeah, birds' fault.
Birds die all the time.
Yeah, truly, daily. A bird flew into my goddamn window the other day, and I yelled at it and scared it away. I made a really loud noise. It was just sitting perched, and Danny's scared of birds, so I had to protect her from the pigeon.
Mom, the bird's in my room. It walked on my pillow. Okay, now we're at the first Chang Annie acting scene. Chang's waiting for his turn to audition as the Karate Kid, with Annie just showing up as moral support. I don't think there's any jokes here. What makes you laugh? Help me. I want to find the funny.
Chang's performance makes me laugh. Just Ken Jeong's utter greatness.
I don't find anything fun. I really like Jason Mantzoukas in other shows. Mm-hmm. I think he delivers the dialogue in this episode that he's given expertly because he's really good at giving that kind of thing. I don't think there's anything for me that plays as funny in him, like, just being a bully to Chang.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a 30-minute episode where a lot of it is that. And it just kind of wears me down.
What makes me laugh in this first scene is when they're doing the line reading and Chang is very dejected and sad. Because in the movie, that's exactly how the actor that plays Mr. Miyagi delivers the lines, and that's why he's like, oh, that was great. So, like, having seen The Karate Kid, it's a little bit more evident earlier.
But, I don't think he says that's great. I guess you're right that later on in the episode.
Get out of here.
Yeah, you're right. But we don't know that yet. We think he's just hating on Chang at this point and loving.
You've seen the movie, and that's exactly how the line's delivered.
But my problem with the storyline, I don't think has anything to do with the Karate Kid part of it.
Sure, it's him being mean.
It's him being mean, and it's them completely dropping the Chang doesn't want to play the Asian guy thing.
Yeah,
we'll get to it when he has the conversation with Annie in a little bit, where Annie's like, well, but being a good actor is taking the role you're given and doing what you can with it. And Chang's like, you're right. And that sounds like horse shit to me.
Yeah. I think it's funny because Annie is, like, doing a terrible New Jersey accent and thinking that she's doing, like, a great job.
Yeah.
And I think
that's
funny.
Some of that stuff is funny. I just don't like that the moral of this storyline within an episode that's trying to have a kind of a moral about being openly yourself, that he's kind of shoehorned into having to put on the accent, having to play the part that he didn't want to play because the white guy or whatever running the show, like, saw something in him.
Jason Mantzoukas a white guy?
He's probably got a shade of something, but you know what I mean. Someone who, like, a director type, like a guy who's just shoehorning people. He says, oh, I saw something in you, but... And you say that that's what he delivers the lines like in the movie. But what can he really see out of this actor, out of
his
two words of dialogue,
sadness,
other than what he looks like?
His utter sadness and pain within his soul, Zachary. As a man of the stage, I would expect more from your thespian eyes.
I just don't like the storyline. I think I would have liked it better if they had Chang say a couple of times, I don't want to do this.
Sure,
or if they
I
had
agree.
Found a reason. I would have liked the storyline if they let him play the Karate Kid and even maybe had Annie play Mr. Miyagi.
That would be funny.
Well, now then you get into the whole, like, how much can we make her look like Mr. Miyagi?
Because she's not going to not do the accent.
Right. I don't, that's probably not the answer then, but I would have liked a version where they would have let Chang play the Karate Kid instead of Mr. Miyagi because he wanted to not just be the Asian guy.
Mm-hmm.
It's funny when they come back to the study room and tell everyone about the parts they got, and Annie's the one that's like, oh my gosh, we got the parts, we're so excited. And Jeff's like, parts? And Annie's like, yeah, I got the part because I'm a good team. And Chang's like, yeah, and I got the Asian part.
It's like in Arrested Development when Tobias goes to audition for that commercial, and Lindsay walks in and says the line and gets the part.
Except that's a lot funnier.
It's true. That is exponentially funnier.
I also like the whole thing with the IT lady of, we're going to need some more time, and then sit back and do nothing. I thought like, that was a pretty true-to-life joke. That sounds like an IT person.
Mm-hmm. Speaking of IT, shout out to the American pilot of the IT Crowd starring Joel McHale.
Absolutely. What could have been?
Also, Zach, I want to make something clear to the class right now. Even though the Chang storyline is my favorite part of this episode, I still don't think it's a very good episode in general. This is not at the bottom of my list, but it's certainly my least favorite of season 6 so far, and I like it less than most episodes of the show.
See, where I disagree with you is I like the episode, other than the ending, but how many episodes have we talked about, oh, this was a great episode, I just don't like how it ended that much? There's been a lot if we went back.
Yeah, but to me, that, like, the ending has a big weight in my scoring of something. Like, if I'm watching a show and the last chunk of that show is dog shit, the show loses points for me.
I don't think it's dog shit, though.
Well, I don't think this episode's dog shit, but if the ending is dog shit, well, this ending's pretty poo-poo.
I think it's fine. I don't know what else to say to you,
and
Steven.
You're allowed to think that, Zach.
Yeah, no, I think your opinion's interesting. But what's interesting to me is that I think the Dean storyline works like A- well until the ending, and the Chang storyline is like C+ throughout.
Mm.
So it averages out at about a B- C+ altogether for me, which is still on a sitcom scale.
Pretty good.
Maybe not the best for Community, but pretty decent.
For the average show, yeah. When I hold Community to a higher standard than I hold the average sitcom, this would be the best episode of Big Bang Theory.
And I think this would be a really special episode of this show if they had nailed that ending.
Mm-hmm.
And if they had... All it really needs is for Chang and the Dean both to have like a moment where they're like, no, this is what
standing
I'm okay with. This is what I want to do.
And that doesn't
they
happen.
Just don't have it, yeah. Very funny when Frankie says something that implies that she doesn't say certain things about her life and her sexuality to the people that she works with because it's not important. And Dean and Jeff very cutely going back and forth like, really, huh? I don't know. I've definitely had moments like that with people before.
Oh, yeah.
Where you're like, oh, they're gay. No, they're probably gay. And then they start talking. You're like, huh? What?
There's a really funny line in an episode of Bob's Burgers where Bob is like, I mean, I'm not straight. Like, something like that. Like, he's like, I'm not, like, totally, you know. That's funny.
Which I think is really important to show in our media that there isn't really just gay and just straight.
Yeah.
You can be only a man that wants to have sex with women and still be like Bob and be like, but there's some males that are attractive.
I mean, you and I have talked about this a lot, but everybody is on, everything is on a spectrum and everyone's in a different level of that spectrum.
Just like,
I mean, I like a lot
of the
things that are in queer culture,
gay,
but I don't identify as anything other than, you know, a straight man, but that doesn't mean that I don't, you know, I wouldn't have fun doing drag and things like that. Like, that'd be a blast.
Or that you can't find someone of the same gender attractive. You just don't want to have sex with them.
Oh, well. Maybe I'm a little further than I thought.
I really, truly, truly, truly have nothing to say about the Karate Kid stuff, about these acting scenes. So please give me something.
And to be fair, I could be a little biased because I like the Karate Kid so much that
and
I'm attaching all these scenes to the moments in the movie. And things like that.
Well, tell me a little bit about that. What do you think that they get specifically right? How accurately? I figure the dialogue is ripped exactly from the movie.
The dialogue is exactly from the movie.
But what about other things, like the setting, the way that they deliver the lines?
Ralph Macchio, who I love, plays Daniel Russo, who's like, I'm from Encino, like I'm all New Jersey.
Yeah.
And because of that, like, it sounds very ridiculous. And like his like New Jersey accent throughout the movie is like
pretty
laughable
bad.
When you hear
Does
it.
Does he still do it like on Cobra Kai?
I hope so. But I'm sure he doesn't because he's like 40 and he can't keep that up. But that Annie's portrayal of that like so confidently, plus like the dejected Chang accidentally being exactly like Mr. Miyagi, who's just this sad old man.
Yeah.
And that's like, it works out so well that it's funny. And I don't know. I don't mind the like fits of rage, crazy director, you know, like I'm distracted by the tools. They were outshining you. Do you like Whiplash? Did you like the movie Whiplash?
Yeah, I do like the movie Whiplash.
Yeah,
but I don't think it's funny.
That's fair.
No, I think
this episode's very funny.
What I think what happens with me here, that's fair, but it's trying to be.
It's trying. That's, I guess.
What
that's...
happens with me is that we're a third the way through the episode. This takes up so much of the screen time, and he's like at a 10 from the beginning, so nothing else he does is anything but at a 10, and it doesn't really make me laugh every single time he does it because it's kind of just repetitive.
Yeah. That's fair.
Although,
I guess I don't think it's funny, but I like it.
Jason Mantzoukas can spit out that dialogue like a machine gun. He does a great job. I think he could have been a great guest star for this show. I think they kind of waste him in this plot line just a little bit.
Imagine
I would have
if he
much
was like
rather.
Like a professor or something.
Him be an adversary at the school. Yeah.
Mm hmm.
I almost would have liked a world where he played like a season-long professor to the class that they have and he just hates the study group.
That would be f***ing awesome.
Yeah. I like Annie's reaction. One thing I do like, this is just about the only laugh I get out of Jason Mantzoukas, is then when Annie really sheepishly is like, is there anything I could do? He's like, no, Annie, you're perfect. Do it all just that way. Unless you want to change it, that's fine. Do whatever
you
want.
Yeah, because he doesn't give a shit. Yeah.
And Annie's like, okay. And it reads well both ways of as if Annie is this perfect golden child or as if he doesn't really give a fuck about the Daniel character, only cares about Mr. Miyagi.
How do you feel about the press conference room?
I always kind of like when they do press conferences in the show just because the world of Greendale is so up its own ass. The fact that we're about to see like 20 different news publications talking
just from
about
Greendale.
The openly gay school board person, it's so ridiculous that I think it's funny. And Domingo just showing up
Domingo
without
is
any
a fucking
explanation
star.
Is very funny. Earlier when you asked me, what do you think about Domingo, were you not a big fan at first?
I like Domingo. I just don't like that his name is Domingo. I
think
the character
itself is funny.
It's too
easy a Spanish word to turn into a name. I'm sure there are people named Domingo. In fact, I know at least in other media there are characters named Domingo. I feel like there's someone. I feel like there's someone in Breaking Bad named Domingo.
Why was it Breaking Bad one of our four choices?
Because I'm not smart enough to talk about like a heady drama like that.
That's fair.
You know what I mean?
Mm.
I feel like I don't have the chops.
And
I
the
barely
episodes
have
are long,
the chops.
So we'd be talking for like 3 hours.
Well, I mean, at this rate, we already are.
Fair enough. I like the idea of Domingo, and I think Domingo, the actor's like performance, is really good.
Yeah,
but
go ahead.
Here's my issue, Zach. Yeah. The dean is so adamant all the time that that's not what he is. Uh-huh. Every episode that's been brought up, he's like, that doesn't begin to describe it, and it's a joke always. And
this
so
is
the
first
dean
time
is kind of selling
that.
Out now for what? You know,
to
like,
be on
oh,
the
it would be nice
board.
To be on
He's
the school board.
He's always wanted to be on the school board.
What does that get them? You know? But let's say that the school board does give him the power that he, you know, thinks it'll have
That's
the
fair.
Influence to save Greendale and keep it safe. I feel like he's... I don't know.
I'll,
I get what they're
I'll
going with
you.
It.
I see what you're saying.
Yeah.
The dean, let's relate it specifically to him later in the episode being shunned from going to see the play by the people around him.
Mm-hmm.
This is him being openly accepted by people.
Sure.
People wanting him, being excited to have him be a part of a thing. And even though it's just to make them look good, it feels good to be welcomed
That's true.
Into a thing.
You know, Zach, I really think that my big issue with it is the ending because they could have done something and they didn't.
And I even kind of think what they're going for, the idea, the antithesis of that point, is a funny thought. that there are people, like, I don't think political was the right way to put it, but no. Just the more the idea that people who feel like they have to publicly announce what they are,
mm-hmm.
that he has to publicly come out as like a person who is that full of himself or something. I don't know what would have fixed it. I think I see their idea. And I do think maybe Artie mentioning that not being a lot of queer voices within
yeah.
the writing staff, maybe they could have taken that joke idea that they had and added a little more substance to it for the queer community.
Mm-hmm.
I really like all of the ways that the school board guys in the same breath will say, well, it doesn't matter to us what he is, but
what
he is
gay yeah.
and he is openly gay and we're cool with that, but it doesn't matter, but we're okay with it. I think that's funny because that is kind of...
Now, see,
especially being
like
in the Midwest, growing up in the Midwest and being in the Midwest now, it
yeah.
definitely feels like it's getting better and that people don't look at gay people as bad or as weird. But there is like still a sense of, but it's something different.
Mm-hmm.
It's not like the norm or it's not normal. It's like a different lifestyle.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just interesting to see how on one hand you can feel like we've made so much progress to where having an openly gay person vouch for your thing can help its cred, but on the other hand we've also not gone very far at all, and
yeah.
gay people are otherized and I don't know.
Totally.
I make gayness look like Mormonism is an underrated line of the sexuality
yeah.
lines in here. And the dean, I think this is the scene that after it happened, Lil and I looked at each other and we were like, that was really good.
Mm-hmm.
This idea of him feeling so dirty, feeling like he's not really being open to himself, and then having like a kind of awkward gay student come up in the way that he's so sincerely like thanks him for being open. The dean saying it doesn't really have anything to do with anything, and the guy being like, no, but it's just really nice to know that someone gay is doing stuff. And just the way that Jim Rash sells all these moments of like, well, is this good or is this bad? Do I feel good about this? Do I feel dirty
sure.
about this? I think it's an interesting thing.
And that's the one part I do like, is because mm-hmm. representation is important. You and I were talking earlier about the Black Panther movie and how, you know, excited I am for the second one and how much the first one meant to me. But it's because you were seeing somebody that you identified with and that, you know, had something that you had be in a position of not only power, but of like acclaim. And so that makes sense to me. I like that.
Yeah.
You know, that's happening. I do like Latino Colorado with Domingo that, and his gay
I think
dean.
That's a good thing. Even though the next slate of Marvel movies and shows looks really, really boring to me, we are starting to see a lot of different cultures be represented in even mm-hmm. superhero movies, which is cool. It is
yeah.
something. However, and I don't know, it's such a fine line. Obviously, representation is good, but is it pandering? And is anything pure? And
yeah.
is any, and even if it is pandering, is it still good just because it's representation? What's the line? You know what I mean? It's tough.
It's like, is it bad to listen to an industry plant if they make good music?
I think it's a little more complicated than that, though, when it's like, company like Disney, bunch of white executives, we want to be more inclusive, so we're going to do a black movie.
Yeah.
You know? And it's good. It's almost like the soul thing. And then they like assemble Ooh. A great team, and they assemble people to put a thing, but then it's like, what came first? The idea to do this movie or the idea to do something that would be a
mm-hmm.
insert other movie? You know?
Yeah.
It's interesting. Now, and it makes for great movies. Like, I've heard Black Panther is great.
Mm-hmm.
It's just, it's weird.
It is. It's a tough tightrope to tiptoe across.
It's more similar than what, I forget what you just compared it to a second ago. Compared to
industry plants.
It makes me think more about all of the female reboots that we get now. And how it's cool to put like funny women or whatever in the front and center,
mm-hmm.
but it also feels pretty devoid of creativity to just be like, well, let's do it again,
but with
funny
women.
Ladies.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. What were we talking about?
They should start doing black reboots.
Well, we tried that once with the Honeymooners, and we'll never do it again.
Fair enough.
And Annie, come on, we've tried it. The Wiz. You've had yours. Time for another Adam Sandler Netflix movie.
There we go.
Okay, so I'd at least like to highlight this moment where I don't even know the acting guy's name. The moment where he pours coffee on Chang, I guess Ken was pissed.
Yeah, and, like, I would be too.
Like, threw a fit about how he doesn't want to do, like, physical stuff. I don't know enough about the situation to really
so
comment on it.
Was that scripted?
No, I think it was scripted, but I think Dan talked a little bit about it in the commentary, that it was scripted, but that there had been a conversation previously where he didn't want to just be the guy that, like, lathers himself up and does physical stuff all the time.
Sure.
And then, like, on the set when he had to do it, I guess he was, like, really specific and really grumpy about how it was going to be done. Mm. And if you watch the moment, you can kind of see.
He doesn't look thrilled.
I mean, it works because his character's literally getting bullied and berated at the moment. All of these moments where the director goes on these monologues about acting and yelling and bullying and, you know, the thing about actors, I just don't think any of it plays funny or inspired.
What about Barry, Zach? What if this was Henry Winkler and Bill Hader?
Well, that's a great example, though, because that show's awesome.
Yeah.
It's all in the writing. I just don't think there's anything. There's nothing unexpected about the way that he yells, and I don't know.
That's fair. They should have just done another paintball here.
No, that's a few episodes from
Gay
now.
Paintball.
We'll get there.
That would have been it.
Britta is an absolute nothing in this episode. I missed Britta a lot.
Yeah.
We only have so many episodes of the show left, and there are only so many characters left, and it's a 30-minute episode, and this is about Britta's only moment.
Yeah. This and when insects have wings. That's it.
In fact, Britta could have been an asset to either storyline as kind of a voice of reason.
Yeah. Instead, she's the bartender. Twice.
I can't tell you how many people I know like Annie that get one little moment to be the center of attention, and then it's instantly like, oh, I am
God's
special,
gift,
and
sir.
I am supposed to do this, and I need to make sure everybody knows about it.
Oh, yeah. Elroy and Abed are sitting outside with the birds.
We could have cut a little bit out of the bird segment because there's a lot of heavy topics that don't get their due, and we just learned about the fledgling period of albatross and sparrows for about 25 seconds.
Yeah.
I do kind of like the joke that it's built up that they have to hide this from the dean, and then as soon as the dean hears about it, he's like, oh, well, yeah, if you move the nest, it'll f*** with the birds. So, yeah, that makes sense to me. And then I even like in a minute when the school board hears the dean did this, and they're like, that might be a little too gay.
Yeah.
I would like to shout out Steven mentioning that they don't do the wax on, wax off scene.
That was not me. That was an email.
As we're watching it happen right now. It's very classic, Steven.
That was from an
totally
email.
Miss a huge, glaring detail.
It was an email.
Mr. I know all 25 fast in the karates.
I even like the original song from the Jaden Smith one with him and Justin Bieber, Never Say Never. That's a fucking bop. No Pun Intended was raised by the power of will. Come on.
As we're getting closer to the last third of the episode, I think what really does the ending a disservice is that they kind of decide to end the Dean story here in a second so they can take like a full 5 to 8 minutes just to show the Karate Kid stuff, which, I don't know, it could go one or two ways. Because on one hand, maybe you've got your like the Nightman Cometh moment, and it's a really wonderful moment. On the other hand, it totally stops the episode. There's nothing about that section of the episode that it's literally just watching the play, and the audience reactions are great. But it doesn't do anything for the story other than to show Chang gets his moment of triumph, but you don't need 6 minutes to do that. You need 6 minutes to tell a nice story about the dean coming to terms with his queerness.
You don't like when he's yelling at Annie, telling her she's not talented?
I do like when it turns on Annie, but I don't think that they quite foreshadow that he's actually a fan of Chang. I think we should have had something before this that hints that he's doing it for a reason.
In the very first scene, Zach, he doesn't tell everyone to leave when Annie's talking. It's after Chang speaks, and he's like, everyone else can go
home.
He could have been like, everyone but Annie goes home.
But then everything else he says for the next 20 minutes is, he literally says, "You're the worst actor I've ever seen. You make me want to kill myself and run out of the theater." That
again,
does not exactly spell out.
You have to push somebody to be great.
And I said it once and I'll say it again. If Whiplash had had just a goddamn paintball thrown in there somewhere, then we'd be talking.
Whiplash doesn't have a gay dean. That's true.
I do think it's funny when Jason Manzouk, when Annie still has to be like, "But you do think I'm good, right?" He's like, "What? Really? Huh?" I do think that moment's kind of funny. I do think they waste Jason
really?
Manzouk.
Oh my God.
Because he's so funny.
You know, Vinnie Barbarino, he could hit the high C all night long.
There's some interesting parallels to be drawn here of how this type of directing might be effective but is not okay.
Mm-hmm.
He says he doesn't yell at Annie because he didn't see anything at her. He, like, berates the people to get a performance out of them. There are, like, directors who do stuff like that, and it's
I'll
not okay.
I'll tell you, in the dance world, there are certainly coaches that are like that, where if they see something in you, they push you really hard, and if not, they don't.
It's, again, just like the race problem that we solved earlier in Hollywood, it's a fine line to draw, because, sure, maybe in certain situations, especially when it's, like, not professionals quite yet, people that are, like, aspiring professionals, maybe a little bit of a drill sergeant mentality can be good, but it's a really fine line between tough love and abuse, and that line is different for every student. And it's not, I think more often than not, that it's not okay.
Yeah, sure.
How do you feel about that in the dance world? Does it make you upset to see people be like that, or
no,
do you think
it
does good? You prefer to be berated.
Yeah, honestly, because it means somebody's taking the time to make me better. I'd rather them do that than just blow smoke up my ass. And
well,
I was the
I'm
same
not,
way in the music,
I think there's a middle ground there. I'm not saying blow smoke up your ass. But I don't know your situation. I don't think...
It depends on what your goals are. If you want to be one of the best in the world, you have to push yourself. But if you just want to have fun, then it's different. Like with my students, some of my students, I push hard and I, you know, make a lot of corrections and let them know, you know, that they are making the
same
mistakes.
But I'm saying more like the pushing hard that this guy in this episode is doing.
I mean,
I doubt
that's a little much. It's
the pushing hard, that's what I'm saying. Yeah. I feel like in the entertainment world or people that have power over performers, that they can be abused.
Yeah, I agree.
What's Tough Steven like? I want to know, what are you like when you're being tough to dancers?
I use a lot of, like, goal-based motivation. And I'm like, you told me that you wanted to hit this goal by this time. And unless these things happen, then that's not going to be what happens. And it's my job to help your goals be accomplished. And I need you to do your part in that.
Okay, but how do you really say it?
Similar to that. I don't yell.
Yeah. Well, that's good. So I think that's fine.
Yeah, I don't yell.
But, and this goes back to, like, something of me as a kid, an equivalent. I had a teacher that I was not doing a good job in school, and I was going to an expensive private school, and she didn't give me any offering of help. She called me to her desk, and what I remember, what I took away, was that she told me that my parents were wasting their money to send me there. And it made me feel
Jesus
awful.
Fucking Christ.
It made me feel terrible.
Like, you don't say that to a kid.
I feel like what you're saying to someone, if you add an edge to that and saying, well, you're never going to get where you want to be because clearly this is what you're doing, that's abusive and that's not good. Mm-hmm. But to also be like, what I'm seeing is not up to snuff, and if you want to get to where you need to be, this is what you need to do.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's different. But just being like, you're not going to do
this
because of
this.
Yeah, that's
awful. Because you shouldn't be discouraging someone or taking them down.
Yeah.
Now, Zach, when I coach you on your dancing, there will be coffee, there will be hitting, throwing, tools being kicked and thrown around, but that's all part
both
of it.
Both in the routine and in the learning of
it. Yeah. We want to tell our story authentically.
This line here where they're talking about what the gays really want and they just want to be like the normals and it kind of breaking the dean's thing, it's a funny scene, and it almost points towards them doing that ending that I want them to do, like the dean being like, this is so fucking dumb. And then they don't.
And then they don't, which is why this scene loses the smoke that it would have had.
Well,
and
they
like
do.
And like the dean's like,
but they make
I'm
it
not
about
a gay dean.
Else.
They're like, oh, didn't hear that. Blah, 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 blah. I think it draws parallels when somebody's trying to come out and say, hey, I'm, this is who I am, this is how I feel, and people don't want to hear it because it doesn't fit their, you know, thing, and that makes me sad for the dean.
It's funny how the whole time they're yelling, we don't see Domingo, and then they walk away, and they're like, oh, hey, Domingo.
Oh, hey, he's back there in the corner.
You're right. You're right. I think what the conclusion needs to be here is what the dean is trying to do is saying that, like, his sexuality is complicated, and he shouldn't have to make that a part of his work persona.
Yeah.
Why did they switch that moral? Which is fine. It's okay to be gay and to be comfortable with your gayness and also wanting to keep it separate from your professional life. Mm-hmm. That does not mean that you're, like, ashamed of your gayness in any way. I feel like that could have been a solution that we draw, is that he just wants to keep it separate from his work life.
Well, and they also don't bring up the fact that, like, coming out is, like, an important thing for people if that's something they choose to do, but it's also something that someone doesn't have to do ever. You don't owe anyone an explanation of who you are and how you feel.
People should be encouraged that should they, it should just be open that if you want to come out, this is an accepting place to do it. Not saying that you are or that you aren't. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. It should be okay to not do that.
Yeah. I do like the stare down, the standoff between the unarmed gay dean and the unarmed black man. That's great.
And that sounds like a party I'd be into.
Yeah. When Domingo shows up at the end of the thing and he's like, Tinkle, you're basically breathing for me. Take a step back. Yeah. It's so funny. That's a good one. I like the Dean storyline interacting with Abed's storyline a lot. I think that is funny.
Yeah, it's cool how all, I always like when they kind of point at that all of these things are actually happening at the same time. They're not totally separated from each other. I also think it's pretty interesting that Jim Rash directed this episode and that he's such a forefront of it.
Yeah.
Jim Rash and Nat Faxon directing it, right? I don't think we needed two montages to the Gay Dean song, even though it pretty much does all the heavy lifting for the bird storyline.
Yeah.
I don't think it was necessary to do the song twice. That's something that you wouldn't do if you had only a 22-minute episode.
Mm-hmm. And I think this is the better of the times the songs performed by far. It's funnier.
It's just because the other one isn't anything but magazine.
Yeah.
This one has, like, a couple storylines and a couple different jokes going
on. I thought it was a little bit dark that the birds died.
Yeah,
NBC might not do that.
I figured that the birds would die, like, at the end of the way that they set it up to think that it's going to, but this is, like, smack dab in the middle of it, they're dead.
Yeah.
And the dean's still wistfully getting success and honored for what he's done, but still feeling like an empty shell for who he is. And this is the scene. What does it need? This scene could have almost been the same, but instead of him saying political, saying I'm coming out as not
me
being gay at school. You know what
or like
whatever.
Just saying, like, you know, I'm more than gay, or I'm not gay, or I'm, or like, I'm not a gay dean, I'm just a good dean, and that's all that should matter. You know, something like that.
I mean,
like
he isn't. He's not a good dean.
Well, he doesn't know that.
Yeah, but I don't know. The show kind of got itself in trouble because it is a complicated issue that you can't just tie a bow on. It just does it bad. The bow that they did tie on it kind of ignores all of it.
Well, and him getting emotional, saying, I'm one of the least open groups. I am a politician. But he's not.
And what does that mean?
No, it's bad.
What they're trying to draw the parallel here that he's only doing it because he'll say anything he has to do because he's a politician to get, like, the title that he wants or whatever.
Yeah.
That it wouldn't matter. He could have had to be a purple dean and he would have done it to get on the school board.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's fine. It's just that in this, it really silences his queerness.
Yeah. And I think that it, like, kind of shits on the fact that he was having an impact on people and having them see something they identify as, but he's like, nope, I'm a politician and that's hard for me to say.
Yeah. You can't just cut to someone in the audience nodding and being like, that's a good point, and have us agree too.
Yeah.
It really feels like they're just trying to get this story out of the way so they can do what they really want to do and recreate the Karate Kid on stage.
Mm-hmm.
And nobody's seen the Karate Kid, so who cares?
Zach, we should just only watch the Hillary Swank one.
It's funny when he tries to leave the wrong direction, and then he's like, actually, my office is faster this way. I'm going to go that way. That's funny. Mm-hmm. And he gets kicked off the school board. It's a stupid resolution. I do think, though, I wouldn't put this episode too low because the half of the episode that does do some good representation is a lot better than what a lot of other shows are doing. And even though it might not be a win of an episode for the show, I think having that in an episode is a win for the show.
Sure. But they literally disregarded it at the end.
Right, and I'm not saying it's a good episode.
They get a spanking for that.
I'm not saying it's a good episode, but they need
they need a SWAT on their tush.
I would rather this imperfect episode that puts the needle a little bit in the direction of the Dean being something other than imp that like dresses up and touches Jeff, you know. Even though I don't love this episode, and it's not going to be one that I pick to watch, and I don't know if it's my least favorite of the season so far, because the second episode might be, but it is one of my lesser favorite episodes of the season that we've covered so far. But I'm still glad that it exists, if only for the I'm not openly anything, and Gata's, the couple of confident lines that Dean gets of asserting his sexuality, I think are important.
Yeah. You know, if gay is 2/7 of the Dean's sexuality, what's the Dalmatian thing? Because he's a lot more Dalmatian stuff in his office.
That's got to be 2 or 3 in itself.
Yeah. I like it.
This little scene at the study table is fun. It's a way for them to all get from here to the theater to see the Karate Kid adaptation and for Abed to share some news about the death of some of the birds. Pretty dark.
Mm-hmm.
And they interrupt the darkness by, hey, isn't Chang's play tonight? Let's all go see Chang's play. Keith David's line of, well, I am a supporter of the arts, but I guess I'll go do this anyway.
Yeah.
This is the first time they've done this in a while. I feel like in season 3 all the time they were... What were some of the other things that they did? Do you remember? No.
Mm-mm.
Well, there you go. This has been the show, everybody. It's been fun.
Not a one.
No, I don't. But I remember them doing that bit a lot and kind of running it into the ground. Mm-hmm. But now it's been a while and I kind of like
it. Yeah, I was pleasantly reminded when I saw it.
And this Dean bit... Not scripted, something that they did while they were making the episode, and Jim was one of the directors, so they were able to just add this in, and it stayed, and it makes the joke, it makes the scene all the funnier. However, this is one of the few episodes, and probably the most Dean episode we ever get from the show, and it ends with him not being invited to the play.
Yeah.
He doesn't get any win. He gets kicked off the school board, he sold himself out, he doesn't get anything.
Correct. That's what it costs you to be...
I know that
gay,
Dean is an idiot and doesn't get to win very often, but I needed him to have a small win in this episode. Maybe even, like, a real connection sparking between him and Domingo. I had a fun day with you. Do you want to go out for a drink? And him be like, oh, yeah, sure, but just don't ask me to do a news report about it or something. You know what I mean?
Like, I don't know if I would have liked that.
I don't need them to date. I just needed something good to happen to the Dean in this episode.
Yeah.
Because nothing does.
I think it would have been nice if the study group was like, well, Dean, you know, no matter what you are, we still love you.
But instead they're like, we don't care what you are and we do not like you and don't hang out with us, but I guess you can come anyway.
Yeah.
Anything you want to say about the Karate Kid adaptation? What details did they get right?
All of them. I think that the saddest scene in the Karate Kid in the first one, which the second one is the best of the series. Yeah, when he's talking about his wife, that's a great scene. And that is, like, a big part of the reason why that man received a well-deserved Oscar nomination for that film.
I think it's really funny, just the idea that, why is this theater doing an adaptation of The Karate Kid? And also, when Annie got kicked out of the play a little earlier, the director said, the only reason I picked you was because you fit the costumes from last year. That means they do this adaptation of The Karate Kid every year.
Every year.
And everyone just kind of goes with it.
I do like that Annie Kim got cast instead. That was really good.
But did we need them to say it out loud?
No. I knew
maybe
it was
some people do, but it would have been funnier if they hadn't just pointed it out.
Mm-hmm.
And I also think it does a disservice. I haven't seen the movie, but clearly the guy who wrote the episode, they talked in the commentary about how much he loves The Karate Kid, and I feel like that shows. I'm wondering if you even like the piggy t-shirt. Is that something? I feel like it probably
The clothes
would
look very from that era. The jeans especially.
I feel like
she's definitely
is.
Dressed like LaRusso.
Really?
All of Chang's outfits are the right ones from the movie.
I just think this section goes on too long, because it would have been different if this was, like, the Karate Kid episode, but instead it's, like, one of the plots in the episode.
Yeah, I really enjoyed this part because I really enjoyed the movie and I enjoyed seeing them, like, reenact it and how good a job Chang was doing.
But that's not... I feel like the episode, if you were going to trim anything, we don't need to see every beat from the Karate Kid recreated.
You don't need to.
We could see, like, two or three of these and add... Because the audience reacting is funny, but we see it for, like, 5 minutes.
Yeah.
And in an episode on NBC, this would be, like, a 45-second little thing. And it could have been somewhere in the middle... It didn't need to be the whole third act of the mm-hmm. show. Like, the Dean is barely in the background of it now when this episode is supposed to be about him. I don't know.
Is it a Dean episode, Zach? Because
it starts with Chang,
it ends with Chang.
You're right. But the episode titles, I do feel often when they, like, reference both things in the episode, the first one... It's Queer Studies and Advanced Waxing.
Sure.
I think Queer Studies is supposed to be the A-plot.
But it's Advanced Waxing, not Advanced Queer. The part where Chang claps his hands and the whole audience, like, gasps, that was pretty great. When Elroy's
even
like,
some
up,
of
Daniel.
The audience stuff I don't buy. Why does Abed care so much? He's seen The Karate Kid before.
Because he loves it. He's getting to watch live action of a great movie.
I don't know.
Don't poke holes.
Weird to me.
In the one thing that makes sense about this episode. Of course,
Steven,
Abed's
all
in.
That's what we do. I don't think it's the one thing that works in the episode. I think it works fine, but I think it's way too long compared to how quickly they wrapped up the Dean storyline in like 10 seconds.
Well, because they wanted to give the better storyline more time.
So you're saying that the Karate Kid is better than being gay? That's what you're saying?
Yes. Objectively.
You heard it here first, folks. 2 hours in, you heard it here first.
Yeah, I also think... Do you see that weird camera thing there?
No, I didn't. Let me go back so I
can go
see.
Back. Look at that shit. That's weird as hell.
It's like panning.
Yeah.
While
why?
The action's going on instead of it should have been straight on the action.
Yes.
I'm a little bit impressed that stuck out to you like that.
It
does
bothered
look
me.
It does look bad, and now that I see it, it does bother me, but it happens really fast.
Well, Zach, I have actually seen a lot of movies before, so I catch on to little things like that.
I liked the reference that Chang couldn't hang out with all of his friends who came to support him because he has to go to the actor bar with all the actors after the show. That is what it's like.
Chang just wants to be in a part
it's
of
like,
a group.
It's like, I have to go celebrate with the other actors, and you guys, like, can't come to that.
Right? When, like, my mom would drive, like, 4 hours to watch us do a show choir competition, and be like, okay, bye, I'm not coming home with you. I'm going to go hang out with my friends at Steak and Shake.
Steak and Shake at 2 a.m.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Thanks for coming to watch me in the middle and back risers.
You're right that we didn't get a good beat for Annie. She watches jealously. Oh, yeah, this didn't work for me. And Lily and I had a disagreement about this. Annie's like...
Lily liked it? Yes. Absolutely not. This was bad. This was gross.
Annie's upset about Chang getting all of the attention, which is stupid, but like it tracks, right?
Sure.
And the way that they solve it is Jeff gives her attention and they do a...
Well, Jeff noticed that little lady needed the big, strong man to make her happy. Yeah.
They did the worst, my lady, my lord. Usually when they do this moment, they choose it right and it's kind of cute, but here it's just...
It was gross.
Yeah. And this ending scene with the birds.
Mm-hmm.
I think that the cat thing is cute. I think the fluttering wings is cute. I think this whole thing is cute. But this was the most inconsequential part of this episode. And it's the big, cute group ending of the episode.
Yep.
That's my problem with it. Nothing really with this scene. It just feels like a rushed non-ending to all of the stuff that this episode brought up. That clearly it couldn't do enough with if it took them 30 minutes. I don't know. They had a lot of stuff they brought up and didn't do anything with a lot of it. This has been a whirlwind of a podcast to do. From like,
why the hell does the episode end with this, Zach?
Literally, going into recording this right now, we hadn't discussed at all what we had thought about the episode.
Yeah.
And immediately when we started the favorite funny moments and I mentioned the school board guys and you big frowned, I just thought this is going to be fun.
This is going to be
this
fun,
is going to
be
something.
This was a hell of a ride.
I got to give Community like B for effort, C minus for execution.
Yeah. I think I'm fair with that rating for this episode. Well, because here's the problem. The writer of the episode wanted to make a Karate Kid episode, but they aren't going to let you make just a Karate Kid episode at this point in the show because you can't.
We also need some gay writers for the gay episode.
And so he spent all his time getting the costumes from the actual Karate Kid movie instead of fleshing out an ending to the plot.
Of him being like, oh yeah, the Karate Kid one, I got it, don't worry about it.
Come on, guys, let me do it. I've been waiting for six seasons for this.
Writer's room is probably struggling to bring everything else full circle, and at a point, they just can't. They got to make the episode.
Yeah.
Well, that's the end of it. This has been something else. It's been a two-hour podcast, and we've got to record another one of these later today. So, let's finish this one up. Who's your MVP for this week?
Mine was easy for me. Benjamin Franklin Chang. Yeah, honorable mention to the Dean, I guess, but not really, because the ending is... I mean, Jim Rash is great, but there's only so much you can do with what he was given to say. Right. I think that I like Jason Mantzoukas in this episode. I think he's just fun to watch on screen, and he really pops and does everything 100%, which I understand why that doesn't always work, but for me in this episode, it did.
You know, this whole episode I've been saying I prefer the Dean plot versus the ending, and I don't really care for the Chang plot, so naturally, my MVP will also be Chang. basically because Ken Jeong has to do a lot of different things. He has to act in a different way. He has to play his character acting. He has a lot of, even though I don't love the storyline, they ask a lot of him. He has to show a lot of things. And so does Jim Rash, but he always does it well. I think this is a showcase for Chang in a way that we don't often get. So I'll give it to Chang.
And I, you know, just jumping off of what you just said, and on, I think it was already said in the email maybe, about seeing actors play actors is really funny. And it's, you know, I don't think about that all the time in movies and shows, but it must be kind of weird to play a character playing a character. So good and job all around, everybody.
To go one more off of that,
mm-hmm.
I think it's fun for me to watch actors play actors and to watch them act as their characters.
Mm-hmm.
It's not fun for me for writers and directors and actors to write, direct, and act directors berating actors.
Yeah.
That's not that funny to me. Well, anyway, this has been an interesting podcast. It went a lot of places I didn't think it was going to go.
Hope you guys enjoyed that.
I've had fun. It's over. We did it.
Mm-hmm.
Next week, we'll be back to talk about laws of robotics and party rights. It'll be another interesting conversation. I'm excited to dive into that one. Have you seen this next episode? Do you know
it? I think I've seen the next one.
Okay, well, we'll be back to talk about that next week.
We're approaching whatever the last one that I saw is.
In the meantime, I guess for call to action, follow us on Twitter at You Can't Diss a Pod to make sure you know when we need the emails for each episode of Community before we record them.
Yeah, thanks everyone who wrote in this week. We had a first-time writer, a long-time writer.
I think Christine had written in before. I think. Huh? Had she not written in before?
I don't think so.
Well, thanks for writing in either way. Thanks for writing in either way. We really liked it, and we really like when you guys write in. So follow us on Twitter so you know when we need written in too. Also, if you like this show, I don't know why you would, but if you like it and you want to support us and help us take it further, Patreon is the best place to do that. Patreon.com/can'tdisappointpodcast. All kinds of extra content over there. Steven, let's wrap this bad boy up. Where can the people find us?
If you want to take our bird nest and stick it in a RV, the best place to do that's over on Twitter. Follow us over at You Can't Diss a Pod. That's also where you'll find out what episode you need to email us about, as Zachary previously said. We're also on Instagram over at Can't Disappoint Podcast. And then make sure that you, you know, take your little acting asses over to YouTube and Facebook, where you can see videos, get all sorts of action. Follow the whole name of the show, You Can't Disappoint a Podcast, with the correct number of S's, P's, and any other letter that's supposed to be in that.
Okay, so I'm going to wrap this up in a way that Steven's going to really hate. From inside the Dreamatorium, political lives matter.
Jesus Christ.
Just kidding. The black ones matter. I'm Zach.
I'm Steven.
We love you guys very much. Let's hope for better next week.
For the last song, can you play, "You're the best around. Nothing's gonna ever bring you down. You're the best." That's from The Karate Kid.
Oh, is it? Sure.
Yeah,
I was, you were doing that. I was like, I will play that, but I have no idea why. what it has to do with anything. Yeah, I've never seen the film.
The song from the second one is, I am a man who will fight for your honor.
So now I have no idea what I'm supposed to play at the end of the
film. And then from the one with Jaden Smith is, never say never, never, never. The Justin Bieber one. Yeah.
Oh my God.
That was from the Karate Kid.
I'm going to play that one.
Please do. I love all those, so no wrong answers.
Can we end this podcast now?
Yeah.
You're the best around.
Oh.